Well, good morning and welcome to the First Baptist Church of Bullhead City, Arizona on a nice crispy little December the 26th morning, day after Christmas. It's great to be here. It's great to see our congregation here. So just so we can prove we have a congregation, because the camera doesn't pick all of you up, say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
See, I told you, we actually have a congregation. Anyway, it's great to see everybody here. We're going to get started this morning with a little tribute to someone having a birthday 2 days from now. Sue, where are you? Right there. Sue's going to have a birthday on the 28th, so
happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
Yes, sir. You know, just another lap around the sun, you know. I think she's going to turn 40 next year.
Ouch.
You know, for the second time. Something
just,
like that.
You just bought it for us.
Well, I'm trying to turn over a new leaf. I'm trying to be honest.
Those bruises are really going to hurt.
It's going to cost me a lot of friendships. Anyway, well, it's great to see everybody here. So why don't we open with a word of prayer, because I need it. And then we'll sing a song. Would you stand with me, please? Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for all you have done for us. We give you thanks that you have sent your Son, that he was prophesied 700 years before he was born, that he would be here and that he would accomplish what he accomplished. Father, we honor him with our Christmas celebrations, and we just pray that you will bless the folks who are in our congregation and watching on our YouTube channel. Father, you are awesome. Your Son is awesome. The Holy Spirit is awesome. And we just invite the Holy Spirit to be with us today, to be uplifting for us, and to let the words and the music soak into our hearts, and so we can take you with us wherever we go. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Well, we're going to sing now, Oh Come All Ye Faithful. All right?
Oh Come
Service. We had that little pause in there, and I paused and no one else did. So This time I'm going to just play on through and let everybody else pause. Anyway, we're a family. It's great to see everybody. Sing with us and greet somebody. Turn and say hello. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountains, cleansed by His blood. Joined heirs with Jesus, and as we travel this God, for I'm part of the family of God. I'm so glad.
Amen.
All right, there we go. Well, why don't you have a seat? Got a couple of quick announcements. No Tuesday night class this week. Renee is still out of town. She's visiting family in California. So Tuesday night is going to be canceled. Beth, Thursday morning canceled this week as well?
Yes.
Okay, no Thursday morning class. You know, it's a couple of days before New Year's, and everybody's still visiting and doing things and eating up their Christmas turkeys and things. And now Wednesday night, yes or no? No Wednesday night. We'll pass on Wednesday night this week. And so we won't do a prayer service this week either, because, you know, we'll just take the whole week off. And that way you can relax and, you know spend time winding up, gathering up all the wrapping paper from the Christmas presents that you've got piled up like this. So anyway, so we'll take the week off this week. Don't forget, on Wednesday, January the 12th, we're going to have Wade Hammond here. Now, you remember Wade Hammond? He's our country gospel singer guy, and he's coming, you know, for the winter season out here to the Southwest, where it's relatively warm. And we're one of the first stops he's going to make on his tour. He's going to be just arriving a day or two early, and I think we may be the very first place he plays. And I just love his voice. He's got a golden, buttery, honey smooth voice, you know, and it's just amazing.
Bob.
Pardon me?
Hi, Bob.
No, a lot better than Bob. And so he's here. It's a no admission thing. It's a love offering, you know. We'll just pass the plate. And he comes up from Alabama. He actually lives there, but he records in Nashville and he plays at the Grand Ole Opry and things before. So he's an award winning singer, gospel singer. So Wednesday the 12th, you know, let your family and friends know. 6 o'clock in the evening, 6 p.m. Wednesday. So we have some pictures that were sent to us from the Philippines. I remember they had a typhoon, and a typhoon is essentially a hurricane. So here they are hunkered down, and got a flashlight burning, I think. I'm trying not to block anyone here. And so the wind outside that room is probably blowing like crazy. And here's what happens when the wind blows like crazy in the Philippines. The next picture shows some destruction. At least there's still a house there. You know, there's a lot of debris. We've got some overhead views too. We've got some drone views of the thing. And that, for example, is what used to be a pest for a neighborhood as well, a village. You notice there's a lot of bamboo sticks and destruction there. So, you know, they probably were handed out some of those blue tarps so they could put some sticks together and have a temporary house, you know, because the hurricane, the typhoon, blew it all down. There's a house in the background there that's roofless. And so you see a lot of debris on the ground there. And even on the roadway down in the lower left corner, there's a massive amount of debris there. And there's another shot there. There's a home. You can see the ocean and the peaceful, tranquil, you know, a little island behind that, or the peninsula, and the village is just wrecked. So those are some of the people that are going to need some support. I think that was the last picture.
Yeah.
So anyway, that's what we're getting from the Philippines. They had a pretty bad hurricane.
Brother Bob brought up an interesting point. If any of you go to Harbor Freight for just a couple bucks, you can get one of those tarps. These are the times when they need those tarps, and they do serve two purposes. If we put the tarp at the bottom of the box when we send that, because it goes by ship, that actually protects the contents inside, and when they get there, they can use the tarp. So if you're thinking about things or whatever to send to the Philippines or whatever, and you drop off Harbor Freight, pick up one for a few bucks, any size you want to pick up, and we use it to insulate the box, and also they can use it when they get there. So thanks, Bob.
Yeah, sure, no point, no problem. The point is there is that those little blue tarps, they used to give them away free, the small ones, 5x7 or whatever, but even a good sized tarp, 9x12, is only a few dollars, so that would be a real good contribution for the people who've had their roofs blown off and things, because it does rain a lot in the Philippines anyway. So anyway, we're going to go on with our song service, and you know, yesterday we celebrated the birthday of a king. Celebration. Remember, though, if Resurrection Day hadn't have happened, Christmas would be meaningless. He'd just be another guy born and died 2,000 years ago. But because he was resurrected when he said he would be, Christmas is very important. So he was born in a stable and laid in a manger. Clear.
Mother and
got plenty to tell you today.
Good morning, everybody. Everybody have a good Christmas?
Yes.
Best day of the year because we celebrate the birth of Christ. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. We celebrate the birth of Christ. As Bob said, the exact day's not known. If you were here a few weeks ago, you understand that December 25th was set because the Bishop of Jerusalem, the Bishop in Rome, and said, people are asking the day of birth of Christ, would you tell us what it is? Because there were so many pagan celebrations around December 25th, the bishop was a smart person. He said, let's put Christ back in Christmas right now. December 25th, he answered right away. Now, theologians debate it, people talk about it, but it's not important, guys. Not really important. It's important because he was born, and he was born to save you and me, amen? We get too analytical as people. We want to get to the bottom of stuff. We need to understand we never really get to the bottom of anything other than our interactions with each other. And after a while, you know what someone's motivation is when they're talking to you, when they're dealing with you. You know, someone's either on the up and up or they're looking to gain something. And this world is that way. And the world is that way because of illusion. There's an illusion brought about by the father of lies, Satan, that you need to be one step ahead. If the neighbor's got a 4-car garage, you need a 5-car garage. But you only have one car and it's a Yugo. I mean, you know. but it's we're keeping up with the Joneses. You don't need to keep up with the Joneses. You need to keep up with your relationship with God.
Amen.
And in doing so, understand that we were sent here for a purpose. God put us here for a purpose. He put us here to learn to love our brothers and sisters. Not to fight, not to argue, not to find a reason to have strife. And because of that, he sent his son, Jesus Christ, and this is the last of a 4-part series where we talk about healing at Christmas. And one of the questions I get all the time is, Pastor, I'll tell you, talk about healing and healing and healing. What can we do? Well, today we're going to talk about what we can do. Let's start this off with a prayer. Precious Heavenly Father, humbly we come before you. Father, everyone has questions, no matter what their age in life, no matter what their maturity. And Father, frequently we hear the question, what can we do? But Father, you are very plain. Your words don't need any interpretation. They tell us very plainly what to do. Today we're going to talk about that. Father, we invite the Holy Spirit to be here. Let it touch every person's heart today in this sanctuary. Let it touch every person's heart who watches us later on YouTube. Let it reach out beyond these walls that people begin to do something. And not do something because the government says so, or this says so, or that says so, or the neighbor tells them to do something because you told us to, God. Let us do something to bring about joy and peace, not just in the Christmas season, but all the year round. Because Father, this can be a peaceful nation, this can be a peaceful world, but only if we listen to your will and your way and follow your path of love. And Father, we'll give you all the honor, all glory, and praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
What can we do? You know, we know that God sent Jesus to heal the relationship of God with man that was fractured by Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. We know we're to emulate Jesus, and in doing so, we show others that God is in us. We know we are to forgive the trespasses of others as God forgives us. Yet, the biggest question I still get is, how or what can I do? I've said before, even the infirm can pray. You don't even need a voice to pray. Of course, the basis for this is James 5:16, which says, therefore confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. Be thankful. Be thankful, folks, for everything you have. Pray unceasingly. 1 Thessalonians 5:16 and 17 says, rejoice always. Pray continually. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. People sometimes stop praying if they don't get the answer they want. Other times, And they get impatient. They get impatient because they don't understand God works in His time, not ours. Others will keep praying after God has answered because they didn't get what they want. Sometimes people refuse to acknowledge their gifts, either out of modesty or lack of motivation. 1 Peter 4:10 tells us, each of you should use whatever gift you have received to serve others as faithful stewards of God's grace in its various forms. The human race has those who work and those who won't work. Which are you, and what can you do? What can you do? What are we sent here to do? We sent here to love our brothers and sisters and to minister to others. You know, it's all about gift giving during this season, yet we're not sharing the gift that God gave us when He sent Jesus to be here. And through His subsequent death, the gift of eternal life. That's why Jesus came, folks. It wasn't so we could start Christmas and Walmart could sell $300 billion worth of stuff. That wasn't the reason. It wasn't so Best Buy whatever could sell you the newest TV set. Mm-hmm. The one that watches you as you watch it. If you don't think that TV's not watching you, let me tell you, do a little experiment. Go online with your computer and look up two or three things you really aren't interested in that you're shopping for. Within 20 minutes, watch your commercials.
Yep.
They will be exactly what you searched. Mm-hmm. If you don't think it's true, you start checking. I noticed it the other day. I looked for something online, and I've never looked for it before. And within 20 minutes, all my TV commercials were about. And I was like, oh, wait a minute. You know? So I got on the phone, and I called my friend who knows computers rather well, and I said, Mouse! What can I do to stop this? Okay, go on your computer. Block this, block this, block this. And when they say, do you accept cookies? Say no. So that's what I did. And all of a sudden, my commercials changed. I was getting some really strange ones in, Bob, but at least it was better than them knowing what I wanted. You know, and you guys know me that I'm a jokester or whatever, and I thought about going on there looking up stuff I had no interest in just to change my commercials. But anyway, the point is not the things that we give to each other, but it's the thing that God gave to us that we need to share. We need to share it. And we don't need to deny the fact that we have gifts. I see people who are, we have some very modest people who come up here on Sunday as part of our praise and worship team. I want to give my hand. None of them are up here to perform, number one. All of them are up here to praise and worship. None of them are up here because they think they have a good voice, even though we have some beautiful voices. You know, I'm probably going to have to live with this for the next year, but Bob has a very nice voice. Stacy has a wonderful voice. Arlene, I am so glad she is back. And Pauline, and Miss Sherry when she's here. Dean is very talented on that mandolin. The little guitar the guys in California called it. We couldn't do without the flute, and that's why I pushed you to get you back in the picture, okay?
Yes.
Need to hear where that sound's coming from. You know, Mickey back there in the booth, and Miss Joanne. Miss Joanne can probably play a half dozen instruments. I know what I'm doing, Bob. Back off. I'll get you now. And we couldn't do any of it without this lady that sits right down front.
Yes.
All her kindness, her kindness. Her kindness to people, and she loves everybody. I'm not even lovable, guys. So let's give them a hand one more time. You know, no matter how much you do in life, you've always got that jokester off to the side or whatever, you know, he's like the stage manager trying to hold up signs and stuff. Well, I'm not like politicians or whatever. I tend to throw toys at them. I'll say toys. I tend to throw toys at those guys and hold up the signs.
Uh-huh. I see who you're looking at.
Yeah. No, if I'm looking at you, I'll do this. Like I did earlier when he so appropriately, and when he was R-I-G-H-T, and he announced that we weren't doing Wednesday night prayer this week. Thank you, Brother Bob. I appreciate it.
Sure. A day off.
Yep. Although he won't tell you, I took the day off last week. I had a bunch of Asian phone calls going on. I was like, Bob, I can't be there. It's okay. But But we enjoyed every day we were here. We were here for a couple hours practicing on Thursday. We were here on Friday with the Christmas Eve service. Those of you who joined us yesterday, over 20 people joined us yesterday, for Dear Chili and Cornbread and Bob's Gingerbread, which is excellent. You know, for the pies and other things and whatever the people bought. We had a really good time.
Yeah.
You know? We had a games master here. We had all kinds of board games and stuff going on. We had a good time, guys. If you missed it, you got to wait till next year. That's what you get. Let's talk about what we can do. Acts 6:4, and we'll give you our attention to prayer, ministry of the word. This, of course, talks about the choosing of the seven, but in fact, ministry is every Christian's job out of love. Do you love your coworker? Yes or no?
Yes.
Yes. Do you love your husband? Yes or no?
Yes.
Wife, children, extended family, enemy, or a perfect stranger enough to share this gift with them? If you don't talk to me about it. Go back and talk to God and explain to him why you don't love him enough to share it. Ooh. That's not a situation I want to be in. And God reminds me and humbles me all the time, believe me. He tells me, he's like, hey, I remember I preached one time in Ecuador in front of thousands of people, and my head got a little swollen. Yes, it will get bigger, Bob. It got a little swollen. And about 3 days later, I was in the middle of Ecuador, and we were lucky to find 6 or 7 people, but you know what? It humbled me quickly. Praise God. Praise God. I've done the same thing in the Philippines. When I was in the Philippines, I didn't want to leave and come back here. I really didn't. We started multiple churches. We had, you know, and I say we because it was me and all these people with God. We had taken a building that was pretty much abandoned, and we had sometimes 9, sometimes 10, sometimes 12 people. Now you see pictures of 300 there every Sunday. Praise God. Well, Roy's head got a little big again. You know, God said, no problem. And I didn't want to leave, and he was telling me to leave. Normally when I go somewhere, I feel the push, the pull, and the peace when I get there. And I was feeling the push. I was resisting. I was pushing back. You know, I don't want to go, God. We got this, and we got this to do, this to do. So God said, okay, I'll show you. And he did. He told me, he said, all these wonderful things happening or whatever are because of me. I am God. I said, I know that, God. He said, I want you and need you where I want you and need you, not where you want to be. And I thought, okay, but here is, and I actually said that word, but. Miss Beth and I discuss this sometimes. You ever say but to God?
No.
So he sent me to these churches that we've been part of, where he told me not to show myself. So I'm riding my little Honda 125 motorcycle all up through the mountains and enjoying myself. And, you know, and I get off in the bushes, because there's plenty of bushes there, Bob, when the typhoons don't come through. And I get off in the bushes and I'm watching, and I watch this little church or whatever. There's nothing but a bunch of bamboo poles and a thatch roof overhead. And these people are praising God, and they're jumping up and down. They're so happy. And I see so much light, and I step out. And it was like someone dimmed a candle, and my heart just sunk. Like, oh my God. It's a shame-based culture. And so they're very quick to step down. And I said, oh my God, I am inhibiting their growth. It's time. I've taken this little tree far enough. I can't take it any further. And I've only done it because God only equipped me to go that far. And I said, wow. So I started praying, saying, God, where should I go? Then I get that phone call. Could you come to Bullhead City, Arizona, and help me? Somebody I hadn't heard from a year and a half. I'm going to be doing a church down there starting February 18th. So I prayed about it. And I'm looking for Bullhead, Arizona on the map. I'm envisioning one stoplight, one gas station, and a guy sitting on a front porch going, yep. But I prayed about it, and God said, go. So I jumped on a plane, flew here. The first thing I see is I'm coming in from Las Vegas. A guy came pick me up. He brings me in here. And all I see is the lights of Waltham. I'm like, this is a casino town? I'm like, Lord, you know my background. Is this where you want me? Well, come on out, and we're here. that after I'm here, and the second Sunday we were here, one of my favorite songs is In the Garden.
Yes.
Haven't done it in a long time, Bob. One of my favorite songs is that. And I was in this church, and they did In the Garden, and I felt that peace. And I said, I got the bush, I got the pole, I got the beast. Praise God. Amen.
Amen.
Give our attention to prayer and the ministry of the word, not what we want.
That's right.
We frequently, what we want is not good for us.
That's right.
Huh? We frequently want something that's not good for us. So if you love your co-worker, husband, wife, children, extended family, share the gift that God gave you. Mm-hmm. They may not want it. They may fight against it. I know people who fight against God, and it's because they got that devil sitting up on their shoulder. You know, and they got people in their ear. Being a Christian is not fun. Yeah. Well, it's the most fun I've ever had in my life, amen?
Amen.
And not only that, you know, I know where I'm going. Amen. And you better need a heat shield. You may go in there too. We're going to go back to 1 Peter 4:10 that we touched on earlier here. Each one should use whatever gift he has received to serve others faithfully, administering God's grace in its various forms. We just mentioned this. Are you denied a talent which is a gift of God? I had a conversation this week with a lady in Asia who professes to be Christian. But she kept asking, why has God burdened her and her family so much, expecting them to do ministry? I said, whoa, wait a minute. I said, that's not a burden, that's a privilege. But we can't do this if you trust in God, if you have faith. 2 Corinthians 5:7, walk by faith, not by sight. If you will walk by faith, not by sight, God will provide. Amen?
Amen.
And it took me about a half hour trying to explain it to her, and I still don't think I got through. But I prayed for her afterwards, and all of us just prayed for people, not just her, but everyone who thinks, well, it's not possible, I can't do this. I'm going to tell you, I had this conversation yesterday with someone standing in that kitchen. I said, the more I do for God, the more he blesses me.
Yeah.
I said, I told them how I came here, whatever, 3 suitcases, had some stuff in storage in Reno, Nevada, and that's about it. You know, and now I've got a decent house that I live in, very nice house I live in. I've got a car, I got a motorcycle, I got a boat. You know, it's God. The more I work for him, the more he blesses me. It happens for everyone. And trying to explain that to this lady was, boom. I explained to a pastor about a year and a half ago, an area pastor. He said that he and his wife had always been hesitant sometimes about giving to the church because they didn't have enough. But I said, God provides. He always provides. He confessed to me about 2 weeks later. He said, since we started doing this, all our finances have cleared up.
Mm-hmm.
I just laughed. I said, I told you. I've been through it. I've been there. I know. I am telling you. God provides. Utilize your talents. Utilize your resources. If you can sing, sing. If you can't sing like I can't, do it anyway. If nothing else, I do it to aggravate Bob sometimes. If you have a gift of something you can utilize, utilize that gift. You know, Nathan can sing. He's telling us that. Huh? Nathan has no doubt he can sing. Amen, Nathan. Sing it out, baby. Keep singing it. Utilize your gifts for God, not for yourself, for God. I know we have talented people in here. We got a lady in here today, and I'm not gonna say her name, but she'll know who I'm talking about, who does artistry work. We got a couple artists in here. But she comes in or whatever when we were doing the kitchen and the hallways and stuff, and in spite of the fact or whatever, I know she had some back problems and leg problems, she was stooping down in the corners and painting a little trim around doors and painting this and painting that. Thank God for it. I knew that was painful. I know she was hurting, but she kept doing it. We have a lot of people like that. We have one who told us yesterday in the kitchen wasn't good for anything or whatever. We had to tell them whatever, but your name is on these walls all the way around. It's because God gives you the talent to do something, but it also gives you the strength. He gives you the strength. Folks, trust in God. Again, 2 Corinthians 5:7. Walk by faith, not by sight. And he's got you, okay? He's got you. Don't worry about it. Trust him. He's got you. But you've got to utilize the gifts he gives you. Don't question, why would God put me in this position? Mm-hmm. Believe me, when I saw those lights of Laughlin coming across the desert, I was like, what in the world? Mm-hmm. But I didn't question. I said, okay, God, you got a plan. I know you do. And his plan's so wonderful. I've seen so much growth in this church. I've seen the church grow. I've seen the people in the church grow. I've seen people turn to God more and more in what they do. And that's all a blessing. Amen?
Amen.
Always. His plan's always better, guys. 2 Corinthians 5:20. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God, making his appeal through us. I stand at that door on Sunday after church, and I hear people say, wonderful sermon, wonderful sermon. It's all God. And nothing to do with me. I have said many times, to those of you who come here regularly, I would like for there to be a big curtain up here that I can stand behind. Because it's not about me, it's about him. It's about his work. If I could deliver his work behind a curtain, I would. Might be easier on some of your eyes too, but you know. Can't do it. Bob won't put the curtain in. We blame it on Bob. And yeah, if you offer to put a curtain in or whatever, Bob will deal with that, not me. But be reconciled to God. Implore you on Christ's behalf. Be implored on his behalf. He wants you to spread his word. He wants you to spread the gift. When you come in and you do things, when you do for your neighbor, when you help your relatives who are infirmed, you are doing God's work. Amen? God loves you for that. He loves you for that. He just went, when you have patience with someone who is beyond patience, how many of you have one person in your life like that? Come on, let me see some hands. Beyond patience. And yet you implore patience. Stop looking at one another. Don't do that. Beyond patience. But yet you have that patience. God puts that patience in your heart. He gives you the strength to do that. And he blesses you for it. Amen?
Amen?
He blesses you for it. It's tough sometimes. I don't know how you guys deal with me. I really don't. You know? It's just the way it is. I really don't sometimes. But I thank God for you. I thank God for your prayers. I thank God for your support. I thank God for the fact that I am privileged to stand up here on holy ground on Sundays and any other day he wants me here.
Amen.
You know?
Amen.
Because it's all about him. Amen.
Amen.
On Christ's behalf. Think about that. You're allowed to do something on Christ's behalf. The King of Kings. The Lord of Lords. And you. I don't know about you, but I don't have a high opinion of myself. I'm like, you picked me? Okay. Mm-hmm. Some of the people, whatever, were amazed or whatever when they found out or whatever I was a pastor or whatever. They were amazed first time when they found out I was a cop. They were like, huh? Him? And of course, I always said, well, it takes a criminal to, yeah, that worked. I said, so in my mind, it takes a sinner to tell another sinner about what Christ is all about. And be not mistaken. Romans 3:23. We have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
So admit you're a sinner. I did that. I've been there before. I have lost my patience with friends. I have been bad on so many terms. Not legally. If so, they haven't caught me yet. So, if you want me to get caught, share this on YouTube some more. Someone said to me this morning, whatever, they had a relative watching. And I said, well, if that relative is watching, I said, you know, subscribe for the husband. And the person piped up and said, well, they got 3 children too. I said, good, now give us 5 more. Come on, guys, let's get that thing going. We're 59 now. We need to get to 100. When I watch a guy ride the motorcycle for 10 minutes or whatever who can't ride a motorcycle, I mean, this guy goes down one year you ever want to see. and he's got 10,000 supporters. I'm like, wait a minute. Maybe I need to get out there and do five. No, you can do that, Bob. You have a two-wheel motorcycle. Go, just go out there and fall down a couple of times, you know. But do it on our website. So. We'll have 10,000 subscribers tomorrow. Bob will have managers. I wouldn't ask you to do that, Bob. I really wouldn't. I wouldn't. Be reconciled to God. Do what you do for God. Do it on His behalf. 1 Thessalonians 2:4. On the contrary, we speak as men approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel. We are not trying to please men. I'll stop right there because here's another thing. How many times have you said, let me tell you about Jesus? I don't want to hear about Jesus. That means you really need Him. Don't do it from a position of, I'm better than you, though, because I'm telling you, because that's the next thing you're going to hear. You Christians think you're so good. I'll just get them. I'll say, I'm worse than you are. Been worse, done worse, thought worse. If He fixed me, He can fix you, too. And at that point, then you get, they're like, that's not the way He's supposed to respond. I'm sorry, I didn't play the game the way you wanted. Are you going to go cry? If you cry, cry to God. I'm praying for you. You can turn anything around, not of your own knowledge and wisdom, but of God's.
Amen.
God can turn any, I'm telling you, He turned a raging river. He stopped the waters.
Yep.
He parted the sea. He can open that tiny crack in someone's heart, let that light shine in there. If He uses you as a pipe, as a conduit for it to come through, He might use you as a pipe to whack them over the head with. Not physically, but use you. If they keep saying, I don't want to hear it, and you keep saying it, but you say it gently with love, and you say it because you've been there already, guess what? A lot of times men will say, okay, I'm so tired, talk to me for 20 minutes. A lot of times 20 minutes is all it takes, because if you can't find the words, God will give them to you, amen? Miss Beth talked to me about that this morning. She talked to somebody. She said, she told them, let the Holy Spirit take over. He'll give you the words. Sometimes I say words or whatever, and I'm like, huh? Where did that come from? Oh, thank you, Lord. Because He finds them when I can. He's God. He knows what it takes. We are not trying to please men, but God, who tests our hearts. People will test your patience. God will test your heart. Don't use flattery. Don't use feel-good religion. Tell the truth. Don't mask it or make it easier to swallow. Speak it in love. But tell the person their spiritual house is on fire. The other day, I said to Miss Beth, God had given me some words when I was speaking to someone about my harshness. They said, you can be harsh. I said, yeah. I didn't write it down, but they stuck in my mind. Here's what they were. If I preach feel good and all is well and someone hears me, goes to hell, I pray God judge me severely. If I preach truth, consequences, hell, and damnation, and someone hears me, goes to hell, I pray God have mercy on their soul. Period. Judge me harshly. If I preach feel down, watered down, good feeling religion. But if I preach to you the word of God, and God is my witness, that's what I seek to do every day. If I preach to you about the word of God, and I'm harsh, and I hurt your feelings, you go to hell anyway because you don't listen, then I pray God have mercy on your soul. That's just the way it is. And if you don't like me because of it, oh well. I will never apologize for preaching His word. Period. Never, ever, ever. And if it hurts your feelings, your problem isn't with Pastor Roy, your problem is with God. And you know what? If you talk to me about it, we'll get a bunch of people together. We'll pray for you, whatever. We'll straighten that out too. Amen?
Amen.
It's all about telling the truth. God is the truth. He's always working. Always. We need to always be working. We need to always be doing something. Acts 22:15. You will be His witness to all men of what you have seen and heard. Don't be afraid to witness. About 18 to 20 months ago, a person in this church asked about mentorship and said they didn't know how to teach or spread God's word. I said, trust God, He will handle it. Now that person is a wonderful blessing to this church. Everyone who encounters them is blessed by them. very active in this church doing things. I didn't single that person out and say who he or she was. I actually use gender-neutral terms, and that's a difference for me. But I'm not going to use a gender-neutral Bible. I talked to somebody yesterday about that, too, whenever Dan had been coming out with a gender-neutral Bible. That's scary.
Yeah.
You know? You're going to call God it, Bob? No. He's my God. He's my Father in heaven. Amen?
Amen.
Period.
Yep.
If he's truly your Father, witness to his goodness. Witness to all men. That's what we need to do, folks. Don't be afraid to witness. As it was in Jesus' time, so it is now. God is his word and doesn't change. Acts 1:8 says, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, Samaria, and to all the ends of the earth.
Amen.
Not just in that time, in this time. That YouTube channel was the furthest thing from our minds a couple years ago, wasn't it, Bob? Now it touches a lot of people and we know them. We just need to get some more of them to subscribe. But whether they subscribe or not, as long as it touches somebody. If you share it and they don't subscribe, that's fine. If you share it, touches someone's heart, they go to church down the street, 2 weeks later they're saved, praise God. I don't care what church you go to. Okay? It's not about numbers sitting in these pews. It's about hearts and souls turned to God. Amen?
Amen.
That's what it's all about. And that's what it should be about. I don't stand up here to please you. I stand up here to please God. If that's a problem with you, then, you know, it's a problem with your relationship with God, which is individual. We all have different perceptions of what heaven will be. Some of us think of chocolate fountains. I'm not speaking any names. Some of us think of motorcycles and guitars. I'm not speaking any names. You know? Some of us think of constant bluegrass and all the fried chicken they want. I'm not speaking any names. Huh? But you know what? Just like that is individual, your relationship with God is individual. Never let someone tell you, God told me that you should do this. Oh, no. God never needed an interpreter in my life. You know? It's just getting it through his hard skull sometimes or whatever that I'm in. Leave! Not now, I got work to do. It's my work. Then I get that duh look, duh. But he'll drive it home. He will drive his point home. He will let it be known. The Holy Spirit will hit you like a tank and it'll pour out of you. Have faith. If there's one thing you remember from today's sermon, 2 Corinthians 5:7. Walk by faith, not by sight. Have that faith in God, not in man, not in money, not in possessions, not in anything you do. Have that faith in God and do according to what he tells you. Before you can do that, you got to have a relationship with God. Start a relationship with God. Begin it. Start right now. Never too late. So you draw that final breath. If you draw that final breath without a relationship with him, State Farm is not going to protect you. I'm telling you, it's going to get warm. You're not going to appreciate it. We have a job in this journey on life. We mature. As we mature in our spiritual maturity, as we go up that ladder, remember, every time we go out further. And God won't let you grab that next rung until you're ready. Matthew 28:19 says, therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. That's your job. That's my job. If you profess to be a Christian and you aren't doing this, you need to talk with God one more time. Because guess what? He wants you to get it done. What can we do? What can we do? We can go to the Bible, and the Bible tells us, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of... Let's read this together. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. You want to know what you can do? That's what you can do. Find a way to do that. Ask God. He'll show you. He'll tell you. If you got talents, utilize them for God. You got resources, use them for God. If you got friends that are in the wrong place, go talk to them. If they get ticked off, talk to them again. Don't talk to them from a position of superiority. Talk to a position of, I am as bad as you are, or worse, but God fixed it. Don't you want what I have? Yeah. Okay, let's talk about it. And then you might hear those words. We haven't mentioned them in a while here in the church. You might hear people say, tell me more.
Amen.
You know? Then you can tell them more. You can just ramble on and on about all the wonderful things God has done in your life, and just maybe you'll get a chink in that armor. You'll get a little crease in there. God can shine that light in that heart, and we'll get those people. We'll get them where they belong. Get them into a relationship with God. They come to this church, that's fine. They go to the church down the road, that's fine too, as long as they're getting the Word of God. Amen?
Amen.
We'd like to have the pews all full. That would be nice. But it's more important to know that when their eyes close, they have that blessed assurance that they're going home to God. Amen?
Amen.
That's what's more important.
Some churches aren't
A lot of churches don't see it that way, brother, but I don't fit in. I'm the oddball. You got an oddball pastor, guys.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. But you know what? God put me here. God put me here. So I do what he says. Go and make disciples of all nations. Let's bring more people to God in this season, every day of the year. If you're dealing with that person that's obstinate, keep praying about it and keep pushing God. Sooner or later, you'll get a chink in that armor. You know? I'll guarantee you that's a better door back there. But if you push on it long enough, it's going to give. You know? Strongest part of that door is not that door. Strongest part of that door is the screw that holds the latch. Once it breaks, you're done. Keep pushing. Keep pushing for God. You'll get a way in there. He'll get a way in there. He'll utilize you. You're nothing but a tool, guys. You know? Some of us are nice torque wrenches. You know? Some of us old beat up pair of vice grips. That's the way it is. You know? Even the most unmechanically apt person will have an old beat up pair of vice grips. Wow, well, they do almost anything. I beat on them with a hammer. I pry on them with a screwdriver. You know? Yeah, I hear somebody standing doing this. I mean, you know. You're the tool of God made you. Some of us are bright and shiny and can play musical instruments. Some of us look a little rough around the edges. But if you can be a tool for God, whether it be a hammer, whether it be a chisel, whether it be a saw, no matter what it is, do what God intended you to do. This. Make disciples of all nations, spread God's word, and spread it through love. Let them know, hey, God did this for me. Not about me, it's about God. Verse 28:19 is right here. Verse 20 goes on to say, and teach them to obey everything I have commanded you, and surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. Our job, our mission, our privilege. It is that easy, guys. It really is. He will guide you. Start working with God. You don't think he will guide you. It's impossible to find pictures nowadays on the internet of things that you want pertaining to God. You'll go through 7 pages of Buddhas and, you know, evil pictures and all that stuff. Sometimes you just have to find a couple components and put them together. But they fit, and God will lead you down that path. You see that the horizon back there is blurry. That's because you aren't meant to see it. People want to see everything clearly. You won't see clearly. You can close your eyes, and God will take you where you need to go. Don't do it while you're driving. A lot of people around here are trying that. Don't do that, please. But God will take you to where you need to go. He will guide you. Start working for God. The minute that book becomes clear and these words become clear and his message to your heart becomes clear, then you'll know where you're going. And then you'll know where you're headed. And it ain't there.
Hey.
Yeah, that's a good feeling, isn't it?
Yeah.
If you don't know what I'm talking about today, if you're out here in the sanctuary and you're not quite sure of your relationship with God, if you're out there on the YouTube channel watching tomorrow, the next day, or a year from now, 2 years from now, and you stumble across this and you say, I'm not sure where I am with God, we can fix that right now. and can fix that 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365, 66, depending upon leap year. Not a moment he's not with you. Not a moment he won't guide you. All you need to do is go to him and say, Father, I'm a sinner and I'm ready to come to you. We're about to say that prayer. Say it with us. Mean it. Talk to people of like mind. Realize that God wants you in his kingdom. He wants you with your loved ones. He wants you with your co-workers. He wants you with your neighbors. He wants you with your family. He wants you in heaven with him because he loves you. Let's pray. Father in heaven, I know that I'm a sinner. I know that every day I do things I shouldn't, but Father, I'm ready to stop, but I can't do it alone. I need your help. Father, I know that Jesus Christ died on the cross for me. I know he did, and yet, Father, I just can't stop doing the bad things I do. Father, I need Jesus in my heart. I need to take that next step. Father, I need to close out this old year and everything that I've done and that old life, and I need to turn away and I need to turn back to you. Father, is there something I can do for you? Because, God, I know there's something you want to do for me, and I'm ready. I'm ready right now to take you into my heart, to confess in my mouth that Jesus Christ died on the cross for me, to confess in my mouth that I am a sinner, to confess that, Lord, I can't do this anymore. And I need you, God. Use me whatever way you want to use me. Mold me. Do whatever needs to be done in my life, Father. But whatever else you do, take me and take me now. I am yours. Amen. It's just that simple. It doesn't have to be complicated. Take me, God, and take me now.
Yes.
Do it, folks. It's a good feeling. I can't promise you'll act as goofy as I do or whatever, but I mean, you know, I can promise you'll be as happy as I am. Well, Bob.
Well, do you feel like singing another song?
Yeah.
Yeah, I thought so. Well, Deacon Wayne's not here today, so I'm going to ask Beth to come out of the tech booth when we're all through here and hold the offering plate back there. And that way you'll be able to find that. Hello.
We got that handled.
Got that handled, okay. Yeah, no one tells me these things.
That's going to be praying for a couple people, so.
Okay. Hey, there you go. So, another gift from God. Well, anyway, we are going to be wrapping up this year. Obviously, this is the last Sunday of the year, and so we're looking forward into 2022. I mean, remember Y2K and the whole world was going to fall apart and everything? That was 22 years ago in another week. I can't believe I'm that old. Anyway, so we're looking forward to a new year, and so I've got a song here that kind of looks forward. You know, that it's, well, Jesus came to give us what? He came to give us peace, love, joy. Well, let's look forward into the new year and let's hope for those things to come through Jesus Christ. And let's let this kind of be our theme this year. How about this? Let's go with I've Got Peace Like a River.
I've got peace like a river. Peace, love, and joy like a river in my soul.
let's aspire to that this year. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the gift of your Son. We have celebrated his birth this week, and we are looking forward to this coming year. Father, let the peace, the love, the joy that Jesus brings, bring to us, and let us take that and spread it. Let us enlarge that and spread it around. Father, we just pray that you give us what we need, and that we can give other people what they need too. As Pastor Roy said, it's our duty. We are tools in your hands, and we just want to be worthy of your name, Father, to take your gospel and spread it to the world, so that we may have our peace and other people may have peace, love, and joy through us and through your gospel and your gift. Father, we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Be careful out there. We'll see you next week.